morning, dear friends. Today we are going to talk about non-energetic application of nuclear technologies. My name is Alla Udalova. I'm Doctor of Biological Sciences and take a position of Professor at National Research Nuclear University. First of all, I'd like to tell you about our university. I think you know that Russia takes a very good position in the nuclear world. Our university, called the Moscow Engineering Physics Institute, is the best university in the field of nuclear education in Russian Federation. The headquarters of our university is located in Moscow, of course. But today, university combines over 10 branches, which spread over the Russian Federation. The largest of branches is located in Obninsk. It's close to Moscow, only 80 kilometers from our capital, and actually this is a place where I live and work. Recently we opened the first branch abroad in Uzbekistan. Nowadays MIFI is a home for about 10,000 students, and we have a lot of international students today. Over 1,500 of students are foreign international students. And they came to our university from many countries, not only from our traditional neighboring countries, our traditional partners, but also from other different countries. For example, we have a lot of students from Vietnam, Turkey, African countries, Asian countries, and you can see here some data about this. From year to year, the number of foreign students increases, and they now study in different levels of education. Most of them appear in basic undergraduate level, but we have also pre-faculty to prepare students for our education programs, and also we have a master and PhD programs, and also we provide advanced courses for professionals. Here you can see some information about international programs itself. In MIFI there are several institutes which provide training for specialized fields. I represent here the Institute of Nuclear Power Engineering. And basic undergraduate programs in our university are nuclear physics and technologies, nuclear power engineering and thermal physics, nuclear reactors and materials, and so on, nuclear power plants and other programs. Under this umbrella education directions, we have a number of specialized education programs. And we have also the same structure in master level and in PhD level. Apart from my usual and routine education process, we have a number of additional activities for students in education, in innovation, in cultural and in scientific life. Just one example, every year we organize summer schools for students, and here you can see the list of such schools which are realized in English language. A few words about our international campus. We have two locations for international campus, the largest one in Moscow. It consists of over 1,000 places for international students, and also we have campus for foreign students in Obninsk. Now over 300 international students live in Obninsk. Both campuses are equipped with modern premises, and our students have everything what they need for life and studying. So now let's proceed to our main topic: non-energetic application of nuclear technologies. What I'm going to talk about? Well, many people today know that nuclear technologies are applied in the field of nuclear power engineering. I mean nuclear power plants, which are used to produce electricity from nuclear reactions. But this is purely energetic application. Nowadays, many things are changing, and more and more interesting are fields of non-energetic application. Here we can use different unusual properties of ionizing radiation and nuclear to utilize them in our to solve our problems. What problems are there? Today there are many fields where we can use nuclear technologies, but during my short presentation I'll have time to mention only three of them. I'll talk about applications in agriculture and food production, in healthcare, and a bit in arts and science. Well, let's start from agriculture and food production. Many people believe that radiation is something dangerous. It is lethal. It is not good. It is strange, awesome to hear that radiation can be used in life sciences and in such fields of activities as agricultural production. But actually, I must say that the effect of radiation and of other factors or powers depends on the dose. Using different doses, we can get very different effects. So from the beginning of our knowledge about ionizing radiation, scientists discovered that low doses of radiation could have a stimulating effect. This is so-called radiation hormesis. And today, this effect is used in agriculture, for example, to improve our harvests. So if we give small doses of ionizing radiation, for example, to seeds or to other planting material, we can stimulate these seeds or these fruits to better development, to faster development, to better survival. And in this way we can have better result in terms of harvest. Today, pre-sowing irradiation, it means that it's used before sowing. Pre-sowing irradiation is mainly used for seeds of crops and vegetables. But it's also used very well for root vegetables, pre-sown irradiation, especially for potatoes. It's very effective. And we can get not only better rates of growth and development, we can also have better taste and content of nutrition. For example, in potato, in watermelons, in some other vegetables, we can have high level of sugar if seeds were pre-irradiated. And also we can have a higher content of other nutritive substances in some of plants. Stimulating effect of radiation is used today not only for plants growing, but also for cultivated animal growing. If we increase the radiation dose a bit, we will proceed from stimulating range to inhibitory range of doses. Again, we need it. Inhibitory effect of radiation is used in agriculture and food production today to delay sprouting of roots. Here again, our lovely potatoes. Every country, people in all countries over the world eat potatoes and like it. But we all know that after harvesting, potato could be kept only for several months, even if we use cooling And by the way, cooling is very expensive because it needs electricity. There are different methods to delay sprouting. Usually, as I already mentioned, it's cooling systems. And also today, people use chemical treatments. These chemicals damage these young sprouts, and in this way they stop development of new offspring. The same effect can be reached with radiation, and as in radiation damage these dividing cells in young growing sprouts and stop the development. In comparison to chemical treatment, radiation is much better because it provides a uniformity of treatment. I mean, you know, it's difficult to provide uniform treatment with chemicals for bulky products, but ionizing radiation easily penetrate substances for large distance, and in this way we have very homogeneous dose field distribution. Radiation treatment provides long-term effect. You'll never need secondary treatments because the first single treatment is enough to stop sprouting. It is surprising to many probably that radiation treatment is much more environmentally sound comparing to chemical treatments. Chemicals are not good for the environment and for the health of people, not only at the stage of product treatments, but also at the stage of chemicals production. And at the end, radiation treatments are cost effective. It's not expensive, actually. Inhibitory effects could be used not only for sprouting delay, but also for ripening delay. You know, in tropical countries, we have a lot of excellent fruits and vegetables. Other countries, northern countries like Russia or Europe or United States of America, are quite interested in buying, in exporting these fruits and vegetables. But the way is long, and we lose a lot of these products during transportation. The best way to improve this situation is inhibition of ripening. Radiation effects here similar to the previous case with inhibition of sprouting. So low doses gives us some low-level damage in biochemical processes, and we have delay in ripening. There are a number of good examples how different countries solve their problems with export of wonderful tropical fruits to other countries with radiation treatment, of course, I mean. If we increase doses more, in this case we can really get lethal effects, that effect that many people are afraid of from radiation. But let's turn this weapon, this tool, against our problems and against our enemies. In this case I mean pest. Harmful insects that damage our harvest, our food, and cause a lot of problems for farmers, for trading nets, and for customs, of course. I'll give you a more interesting example about insect control a bit later with radiation, insect control with ionizing radiation. But now in this place, I'd like just to say that radiation treatment of pests is a very good tool. especially if we compare it to chemical treatments. Again, traditional pesticides, insecticides that are used now very wide are not very good. They have a lot of disadvantages. You know very well that insects are able to adapt to chemical poisons very fast. They became resistant, tolerant to these dangerous poisons. And we need to find other new, more dangerous chemicals. Usually we can get full extermination with chemicals. Some insects can stay and they develop and give large progeny. I've already mentioned about problems with uniformity of treatment, and radiation here can resolve many of these tasks, many of these problems, and well, here on the slide are advantages of radiation treatment of pests for their extermination or at least for the control of their population. We can use ionizing radiation as a lethal weapon not only against pests and insects but also against microbes and bacteria. Today in the world we have two large problems. The one is shortage in food and food security in the world. You know, hunger in the world. And also because of long transportation of food products and bad conditions for storage of these products, many of them are spoiled, and many people get diseases from spoiled food. To improve situation in this case, food irradiation is widely applied today in the world. In this case, we apply ionizing radiation to kill microbes, bacteria, different parasites, and extend shelf life of food products. This tool is used for different types of food products. Most widely, it used to treat meat products, including fish, poultry, seafood, and also it's used for spices and seasonings and other dry powders, something like this. How well does it work? Imagine that you have a piece of meat. Put it on your table in your room at room temperature. I think that next morning you mustn't eat it. It's spoiled already. But if you irradiate it, of course you must pack it in a vacuum package to prevent secondary contamination. So this irradiated piece of meat will lie on your table for a week, 7-10 days, without any changes in its taste and quality. Not bad. If you put this piece of meat into fridge, not in the deep frozen camera, but just in usual fridge camera, you can keep it for months or even more without any negative changes. Of course, this is very, very good for farmers, for transportation, for commercial purposes. And today, food irradiation is approved in about 70 countries and actively applied in 40 countries where there are over 200 irradiation facilities, irradiation plants. One more field of application of nuclear technologies, healthcare. Here I think you have some basic knowledge because today many people know about nuclear medicine. So I'll give just a few examples of all this, how it works, and maybe a couple of most interesting applications that isn't used today. So in medicine, in total, we separate two fields: diagnostics of diseases and treatment or therapy of diseases. Diagnostics with radiation technologies are known over 100 years. I talk about radiography. I'm sure that you know about this method. In this case, a source of external irradiation is applied to take a kind of photo of internal structure of human body. Radiography was first applied in the end of 19th century, right? Just in very short time after X-ray were discovered by Wilhelm Conrad Röntgen. Since then, this method hardly changed in principle, but of course we have today better equipment, which provides a low dose of radiation, but very good resolution. And one of the most developed and popular methods today is computed tomography. In the case of computed tomography, we have X-ray source which rotate very fast in this device and takes photos of patient from different directions. Also, patient is moved horizontally, and in this way we take hundreds or thousands of snaps of internal structure of the whole body or of a part of a body, and when we put it in computer we can have very good three-dimensional model of all internal organs. Resolution is very good. Doctors can see very small defects, something that mustn't be in this place, and so we can recognize damage or disease and the very first stages of its development. Other method of diagnostics with nuclear technologies is so-called radionuclide diagnostics. In this case, radionuclides are used. And radionuclides are injected into human body in this case. Usually they are used as a part of so-called radiopharmaceuticals. Radiopharmaceuticals is just chemical molecules which are designed in such a way that when they appear inside human organism, they go to the right place. Whatever we want, to a leg, to a brain, to a thyroid, or somewhere else. Well, this is so-called targeted approach when we can aim these small boats. I would say that chemical molecules looks like boats. We can aim them to the organ we need to check. And these boats take also radionuclides inside. In nuclear diagnostics, they used radionuclides with low levels of radiation, and they help us to see what's going inside the organism. So if in the first example of radiography, we apply external irradiation. In the case of radionuclide diagnostics, we use internal irradiation. This irradiation could be registered with special devices, and again, we can see what's going on inside organs and organisms. When disease is found, of course, we need to treat it. And nuclear technologies and radiation technologies provide very good tool to treat many diseases. I think you know that these approaches, nuclear technologies and radiation, are widely used to treat cancers. And why is it so? The matter is radiation is especially dangerous for dividing cells. When cells are dividing, they are very sensitive to ionizing radiation. And tumor cells are such cells that do nothing of their specialized functions. They forget about their functions. They only consume nutrients, grow and divide, and the tumor growth in this way. So these dividing cells are very sensitive to radiation, and nuclear radiation technologies are extremely effective in treatment of cancer diseases. There are many of methods today, and here in this slide I show only one example of a so-called gamma knife. Gamma knife is used to treat cancers of brain. If a patient has a cancer in brain, what are traditional methods to treat it? Traditional methods include surgery, right? And a surgeon must open the scalp. This is a very severe operation with deep anesthesia and with long period of recovery after such operation. Radiation technology is a non-invasive technology. In the case of gamma knife application, a patient is put in such a device, and here we have a lot of gamma sources inside of this device. With the help of computer, we plan irradiation pattern in such a way to provide a cross-section of used gamma rays, gamma beams, in a place where a tumor is located inside the brain. And it's planned with very high precision, so we reach a cross-section on these beams, and at the place of the cross-section we have very high doses of radiation which are effective in killing tumor cells. All other part of brain and all other part of human body, of patient body, is radiated at very, very low dose, so that this operation could be done even for pregnant women. And now try to compare. If we have traditional surgery, a patient needs several months for recovery. After a gamma knife operation, a patient experienced no anesthesia, experienced no pain, nothing at all. In several minutes after this procedure, he or she can stand off a couchette and go home. I think it's fantastic. The second example is in line with the method of radionuclide diagnostics, but in this case we use the same technology for treatment. The difference is only in a type of radionuclides, because in the case of diagnostics we needed low doses just to illuminate what is going inside, but in the case of therapy we need strong radionuclides effective enough to kill tumor cells. But again, in today's radionuclide treatment, they are used radionuclides, radioisotopes of a short half-time period, so that they could come to tumor, kill tumor cells, and decay completely, and don't provide additional doses of radiation exposure to a human body after they killed the tumor. And here in this slide you can see example of iodine-131, which is often used to treat thyroid cancers. Probably you know that human thyroid consume a lot of iodine, well, stable iodine isotope. And nearly all iodine which appears in our organism goes into thyroid gland. If we add the non-stable isotope, for example, iodine-131, it will also go to thyroid gland and accumulate completely only in this gland. So this is one of the examples of radionuclide treatments. To do such treatments, to apply such methods, we need radioisotopes. Today there are several, or well, at least three methods to produce radioisotopes. One of them is research reactors. Yes, in many countries, radioisotopes are produced in reactors, and they are used inside the country, or they are sold to other countries. It's a very good international market. Research reactors are used for research purposes, for studying different effects of radiation. There are different types of research reactors for material sciences, for radiobiological and medical researches. They are also used for education purposes and for production of radionuclides. Please mind that research reactors never produce electricity. They are not nuclear power plants. They are small installations. They never used as nuclear power plants. And in the world, there were built several hundreds of such installations. Many of them are already shut down and decommissioned because their life cycle ended. But today, in modern world, many countries are interested in construction of new research reactors. And in Africa, several countries are interested in this. And in other countries in Asia and South America, in many places. Nuclear and radiation technologies are used in healthcare not only for direct diagnostic or treatment purposes, but for some supplements. For example, medical sterilization. This is very important task in modern medicine. You know, we need sterile devices or disposables like masks against coronavirus or other medical products. Traditionally, they are usually applied two basic methods: thermal sterilization or sterilization with dangerous toxic chemicals. Again, thermal sterilization is very expensive, and chemical sterilization is not only expensive but also dangerous for people and the environment, and is very effectiveness of both these methods is not as high as we'd like. Imagine, for example, a sieving. To do sterilization, we need to take different parts of this device and sterilize them separately in sterile conditions. Do you know what are sterile conditions? It is a facility, the plants, where very high levels of purity are provided, and even staff, people in these plants are dressed in such suits that looks like astronauts' scaphanders. This is not because chemicals are dangerous for people. This is because the human body can contaminate air in these rooms, in these buildings. And so, after first stage of sterilization, we need to assemble these parts together again in sterile conditions. And then we need to pack these products and again in sterile conditions. It is very difficult to provide high levels of purity at all these stages, and there is a risk contamination, biological contamination, yes. But when we apply radiation sterilization, we can assemble acerin in usual conditions, pack it in usual conditions, and after this already packed device, we can irradiate and eliminate absolutely all microorganisms from these products. This technology is very effective. This is a gold standard of medical sterilization nowadays in the world. This is cheap, fast, with very high rate of this treatment and very high quality. And here, wonderful example of a very special method of radiation technology application. This is sterile insect technique. Probably in your country you've heard about it, but probably not. What is it? When we have some dangerous insect, we can decrease population of this insect very effectively with sterile insect technique. For this, you need to apply irradiation to especially red insects, and usually they get sterilization in males, because males are usually more sensitive to radiation than females. And this sterile female, these sterile males are released into usual environment, where they mate with wild females. As a result, from mating of sterile male with female, we have no surviving offspring. This is very selective tool, very sophisticated tool to decrease, to control the population of targeted insects. First, it was applied in United States of America in 1960s. And first, they did it in a small island called Curacao, and then spread for the whole Florida, Texas, and other south states of America. Why did they need such technique? This time in America, there were pandemia of some insect. It's called screwworm fly. Screwworm fly is very dangerous for cattle. It eats flesh of cattle in a few days. Animals die. And there were very strong economic effect on cattle breeding in United States of America. The technology of sterile insect technique appeared surprisingly effective. In the Curacao Island, they got the effect in a week after release of sterile males. They appeared no. This insect, these flies in the island, they just disappeared. During several years, they applied this technology, and by the 17th, not only the south of the United States, but also all Central America countries were cleaned of the screwworm fly. And this state is kept up to now. So over 50 years, there are no screwworm flies in this part of the world. It's just fantastic. It's not an island, it's a large territory, and the problem is solved probably forever. Technology was applied not only against screwworm flies, but against many other insects. And so in Africa, for example, a very successful application was done against tsetse fly. Everyone knows, I think, what is tsetse fly. And the method is the same. Males are sterilized by ionizing radiation and released into the environment. It appeared, for me it was a surprise, that the tsetse female mate only once in life. If it meets a sterile male, they have no offspring. So population size decreases with fantastic speed. During many years, this technology is applied and propagated in Africa with the help of IAEA, and there are obvious successes of this. Also, sterile insect techniques were many times used against fruit flies. I think you also know what is it, Drosophila or fruit flies. There are dozens of types of this fly. For every fruit, its own Drosophila. And in many countries, SIT appeared very effective against fruit flies. Here I put a small example that reminds us the effect from SIT application in South Africa to protect orange producers. Well, now let's proceed to our third topic, our third part, which is devoted to nuclear radiation applications in arts and sciences. Here probably it's most charming, most interesting and wonderful examples from all my lecture. Well, radiation has a lot of properties which are very different and very special comparing to other technologies that are used in the world. And well, we already talked about radiation sterilization. It could be used not only for food products or for medical supplements, but here you can see example how it's used to save World Heritage. The mummy of Ramses II has an age of several thousand years. Recent dozens of years it's kept in Cairo Museum. It was kept in the Cairo Museum. But in 1974, they found that this is infected with bacteria and some worms. And so the mummy was under danger. And they transported the Ramses II mummy to Paris, to Human Institute, where it was irradiated with gamma radiation, and all bacteria were successfully eliminated from it. This small example shows that radiation properties could be used to solve very different problems. One more unusual property of radiation is its penetrating ability. And here is also a historical example, very interesting example, I think. Here you can see a piece of art, The Last Day of Pompeii. I'm sure that you know about this tragedy when, because of the Vesuvian volcano eruption, the whole town of Pompeii was buried under volcano ash. Close to Pompeii there were other town which is not so well known among people. It's called Herculaneum, and in Herculaneum there were a very good library. This just storage of ancient knowledge. And can you imagine, even papyruses kept not damaged under a layer of ash for 2,000 years. It's just, well, yeah. And they look like this now. But, of course, we can't read them. There's an idea to use ionizing radiation and do something like computer tomography. Yeah, due to penetrating ability of radiation, we can read, we can see what is inside of these papyruses, and we can read it. And in this way, we can keep ancient knowledge for humanity. More examples of unusual properties of radiation. Well, there are methods which helps us to find chemical composition of different substances. Usually, what we do to find chemical composition, we need a sample of the substance, we take it into the laboratory and do some chemical experiments with this. It means that we damage original piece. But when we deal with masterpieces, we cannot damage them. Non-destructive control methods provided with radiation and nuclear technologies are very good to solve these problems. Here is an example of David Monumentum by Michelangelo. Professional specialists decided that they need a restoration of this masterpiece, but to do it correctly, they needed a very precise chemical composition. So they just irradiated the nose of this monument, nose of David, and by X-ray fluorescence spectroscopy, they found needed chemical composition without any damage to the statue. Spectroscopy gives us a structure of electron shells and shows us only chemical elements. Such a method as neutron activation analysis can give us information about isotopic composition, and this is very valuable technique. Neutron activation analysis determine not only composition, not only chemical composition, but isotopic composition of materials and even their origin, because isotopic composition gives us something like fingerprints. Here in this slide, an example how neutron activation analysis helped in the investigation of the fate of very famous scientist Isaac Newton. Scientists analyzed hair of Isaac Newton for the content of heavy metals, and they found that mercury in hair was much more than they expected. It means that Isaac Newton suffered of a chronic poison. So, this is new information about his fate and life. One more example. Here you can see this beautiful place. It's called Coral Spring Beach in Jamaica. Imagine someone stole it. Not the whole beach, but essential part of the beach was stolen. And police couldn't find the thief because, you know, all beaches looks the same, and it's impossible to tell that this sand is not from this beach, but from Coral Spring Beach. But such methods as neutron activation analysis actually helps us to find the exact origin of different materials. And this isotopic composition, isotopic ratio, looks, as I said, like fingerprints. And we can find origin. And at last, the method of isotope traces. Also very charming, very good and interesting technique. Isotopes are emitting radiation, and it's easy to register this radiation. It helps us to look for different processes, to trace these processes, and we can add isotope markers to different systems, to different processes. It will look like radionuclide diagnostics, you remember, and it's now applied in many, many fields and applications. And so metabolism of organisms, human, animal, or even plants are studied with isotope traces. Different environmental issues, including just fundamental studies or applied studies about contamination, migration ways in the environment. Everything can be well studied with isotope traces. It's also used even in industry processes to see how they happen. A lot of examples. I'll tell only about one field in isotope traces. And this technology is used in so-called isotopic hydrology in light of a shortage of drinking water that we expect in the world, and many countries meet it today, especially African countries. There are special international programs on water resource studying, and isotope traces, for example, are used to study groundwater recharging, water pollution and ways of this pollution, and also they help in finding new resources. We can study age and movement of water in the environment and in underground waters and in atmosphere, in all parts of our environments. I mentioned here one of the program of IA when it helps African Sahel countries in fighting droughts. Unfortunately, the time of my lecture is not 4 hours. Actually, there are so many applications of nuclear and radiation technologies today that I can talk about it a long time. And there are a lot of interesting things and interesting examples. I hope that you got an idea that non-energetic application today is used in many fields, not only science and research, but industry, medicine, environmental sciences, agriculture and food production, and education also. Marketers say that non-energetic application will probably overcome energetic application involved market. So probably your future will be connected, your career will be connected to this field of knowledge and activity. If you are interested, you need proper education, and so I'd like to invite you to our university, to Russia, to Moscow Engineering Physics University. And here are my contact details. If you have questions, you can write to me. Thank you for your attention and goodbye.